them do that.
Taste, yeah.
Outreach with a special passion for missions
in the local community, across the nation, and around the world. He loves leading short-term mission teams to Latin America, which is what he gets to do in his young life. Bruce received his undergraduate degree from Stetson University in Deland, Florida, in 1983. He's giving us his age. Earning a Master's of Divinity degree from the University of Dubuque Theological Seminary in Dubuque, Iowa, in 1995. And completed a Doctor of Ministry degree in Global Ministries at Fuller Theological Seminary in Pasadena, California. He's been around the country a little bit, I see. He and his wife, Cindy, have been married since 1982, and they have two young adult children, Will and Kate, named them long before the Royals got married. Kate is married to Brett, and they have an eight-month-old son, Walker, which makes Bruce a proud grandpa. Bruce is a runner, pretty good, and a golfer, pretty bad. He and Cindy enjoy travel in more normal time and spending time with friends and family. And I do know that he just got back from one of the national parks. Grand Canyon. How could I forget the Grand Canyon? The grandest of them all, right? So he is here now, and I turn this over to Reverend Bruce Hedgepeth.
Thank you. It's great to be here with you today, Grand River Presbyterian, and I look forward to our time of worship together. So let us prepare our spirits to worship God together with an entry and a centering silent prayer to begin. Whether you are here with us in the sanctuary or tuning in at home, would you please stand and join in the call to worship this morning? It is taken from Psalm 99. The Lord is King, let the peoples tremble.
He sits on the throne of the Lord,
the Lord is great in Zion, he is exalted over all the people.
Let us praise your great and awesome name. Holy is the Lord.
Mighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in the land.
Let us exalt the Lord our God. worship at his footstool, holy is the Lord.
As we remain standing, let us join together in singing our opening hymn as the
thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And so now is the time for our socially distanced passing of the peace. When I was here a few weeks ago, there was a lot of waving and greeting that went on, so let us share the peace of Christ with each other. So as we come to the time in the service where we focus on the word of the Lord, we're going to begin with a reading from the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, chapter 3, verses 13 and 15. Listen as I read for the word of God. The setting is likely a familiar one to you. Moses is a shepherd in the land of Midian. He's tending the sheep there in the desert wilderness, and he sees this strange sight of a bush that's burning but not being consumed by the fire. And God speaks to Moses from that burning bush. So that's where we pick up the story in this early part. Exodus. But Moses said to God, "If I come to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am. He said further, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you." God also said to Moses, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my title for all generations." Amen. Let us stand as you are able and sing together our hymn of praise. Gracious God, we believe your word is a lamp unto our feet, it's a light unto our path. Your word from the Old Testament book of Exodus that we have just read to your word to us on every page of Scripture, including these words from the 8th chapter of John. Send your Holy Spirit to speak to us through these words that you have preserved on the pages of Scripture. We pray it in Jesus' name, the incarnate Word, the living Word. Amen. So John chapter 8 is a little bit of a long passage, and I apologize for that, but be patient, if you will, as there's a powerful punch line that we get to at the end. So Jesus is in conflict with the Jewish religious leaders, and we pick up this conflict in verse 39 of John chapter 8. And it's the Jewish leaders who answer Jesus. They answer him, "Abraham is our father." Jesus said to them, "If you were Abraham's children, you would be doing what Abraham did. But now you are trying to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did. You are indeed doing what your father does." They said to him, "We are not illegitimate children. We have one father, God himself." Jesus said to them, "If God were your father, you would love me. For I came from God, and now I am here. I did not come on my own, but he sent me. Why do you not understand what I say? Is it because you cannot accept my word? You are from your father, the devil, and you choose to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks according to his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Which of you convicts me of sin? If I tell the truth, why do you not believe me? Whoever is from God hears the words of God. The reason you do not hear them is that you are not from God." The Jews answered him, "Are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon?" Jesus answered, "I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father. And you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Very truly I tell you, whoever keeps my word will never see death." The Jews said to him, "Now we know that you have a demon. Abraham died, and so did the prophets. Yet you say, whoever keeps my word will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham who died? The prophets also died. Who do you claim to be?" Jesus answered, "If I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, he of whom you say he is our God, though you do not know him. But I know him. If I would say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your ancestor Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad." Then the Jews said to him, "You are not yet 50 years old, and you have seen Abraham?"
"Yes."
Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, before Abraham was, I am." So they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Amen.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God for his word to us this morning. So, have you ever used one of those old sayings and almost immediately wondered, what does that really mean? I mean, like the saying, never look a gift horse in the mouth.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
What's that about? I mean, it's about gratitude. We get that. It's about gratitude. But, you know, for me, no one's ever given me a horse as a gift. Anybody here ever receive a horse? And if someone did give me a horse as a gift, I have no idea why I would look at its mouth. Never looked a gift horse in the mouth. What's that about? So knowing that this would be a burning question in your mind, I did a little research and I found out that with horses, this is a saying that comes from an earlier time, right? Horse is a major means of transportation and work, and what happens with horses is as they age, they continue to grow new teeth in the back of their mouth, and those new teeth push the other teeth forward, and so an older horse is going to look like it's got a serious overbite. It's a buck tooth. The teeth stick out of the front, and so if you are checking a horse's mouth, and you know horses, then you can tell that it's an older horse if it's got buck teeth. So it would sort of be like in our time, if you received a gift and you asked somebody, well, are you re-gifting this from your birthday? Is this a gift that you didn't like? So it's that. So the idea is gratitude. That's what the saying is, having a spirit of gratitude. And, you know, but thinking about those old sayings that we hear or maybe even use without really knowing the backstory, it also makes me think that there are some truths about our Christian faith that we just kind of say and we just kind of speak and that we don't necessarily know the background. We don't know what the purpose of those beliefs are, of that theology that we hold on to. And one of those that we're going to look at today and next week is the Apostles' Creed. When I was here a few weeks ago, I noticed that as a congregation here in Brainerd, we said the Apostles' Creed together, intentionally included it again this week. And you know then that the Apostles' Creed is this series of statements of what we believe as Christians, followers of Jesus, in the Reformed tradition. And in fact, the Apostles' Creed is the most ecumenical, the most ancient of all the creeds in our book of confessions. We use it in worship frequently because it is pretty short and pretty easy to remember. It's really suitable for worship together. And it begins with the words, what? I believe in God the Father Almighty. That's what we will say in affirming our faith in just a few minutes. But if we spoke Latin, any Latin speakers here, what is the very first word that we would say if we were saying the Apostles' Creed in Latin?
Credo.
Credo. Except, do you speak Latin at home?
I took 4 years of Latin.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Credo is the first word. It means I believe. And so that's what we're going to be looking at today, is talking about what we believe based on the Apostles' Creed. And we begin that by considering the Old Testament text that we looked at from the book of Exodus. And that setting, as we talked about, is Moses. He's tending the flocks under the leadership of his father-in-law Jethro, and while he is in the desert wilderness of Midian, he sees this bush that's burning but not being consumed, and we read how God called Moses to assume the mantle of leadership for his people, the Hebrew people, the descendants of Abraham, who had been enslaved under Pharaoh in Egypt. And God's call for Moses was for him to be the one who would lead the Israelites out of bondage in Egypt and into a land of promise that God had prepared for them. But Moses wasn't sure that he was ready to assume that leadership, that he was up to the task. And so he wanted to make sure he had his credentials lined up. And so he asked the Lord to reveal the divine name to him so that Moses could tell the people God's name so that they would follow him. And the Lord responded, tell the people I am who I am. Tell them that I am has sent you. So hold that in your mind. What we have in the Old Testament is this amazing account of how God, the God who created all of the universe, reached out to a sinful humankind in the book of Genesis, and he made a covenant with Abraham, and he promised that he would bless Abraham, and through his descendants it would be as numerous as the stars in the sky, that it would be a blessing to all the peoples of the earth. And as we work our way through the book of Genesis, we see that God was faithful to his promise with Isaac and Jacob. And then here in this text, their descendants had become enslaved in Egypt under Pharaoh. And as we begin the book of Exodus, that's where this encounter with Moses takes place. And you know the story of the Exodus, how Moses did lead the people in those desert wandering years right to the doorstep of the promised land. And then God called Joshua to lead his people on the conquest of that promised land. And there was the period of the judges in which the 12 tribes of Israel moved into the land and the inheritance that God had given to them. And we see the Lord in a setting in which, in the ancient world, in which the peoples all around them were polytheistic. God is forming this relationship with this one particular people, these descendants of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, who believe that there is one true God. The Israelites didn't say to their neighbors, my God is better than your God. The Israelites said to other people, my God is the one God. And what you worship is no God at all. The Lord, in these years of forming this covenant with Abraham, of leading the people through Moses in the desert, of establishing them in the promised land, in the time of the monarchy when the temple was built, and then this messianic hope that was built up that there would be a Messiah who would sit on the throne of King David, and then the terrible time of the exile, the people's return from the exile, this monotheistic people with this hope in a king that would rule in Jerusalem as David had, they believed that they knew God. I am Yahweh. And they expected a Messiah to come and sit on the throne of David. They knew God. They thought. Just like we think we understand these old sayings that we sometimes use, like a stitch in time saves nine. I mean, we get that, right? You know what that means. I hope you know what that means. Because I'm not much into stitches or sewing, and so I got nothing. Fortunately, I do have the internet, and what I learned is that a stitch in time saves nine is really an exhortation that a little bit of effort to address a situation early will save a lot more effort to effect the same fix later. So think about a cloth or whatever. If you get a little tear in it, if you apply a stitch in time, then that could fix it. Whereas if you waited until the tear got bigger, well, it might take nine more stitches to effect the same fix. Makes sense? A stitch in time saves nine. Do a little effort now so you don't have to spend a lot of effort later to avoid big problem. So in the next part of the Apostles' Creed, we say, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. And so the second passage we read from John chapter 8, when Jesus is in this conflict with the Jewish leaders, they were really going at it. Those are some strong words, weren't they? I mean, Jesus was calling them liars, and they said he was a half-breed, and he had demon-possessed, and man, it was like a political debate or something like that. It was some strong stuff going on there. But the punchline, and I hope you caught it, I tried to tip you off to it, was at the end. You know, Jesus is saying that Abraham has seen Jesus. And of course the Jewish religious leaders go nuts. What he's saying is, it's craziness. It's lunacy. Jesus is 30 years old. And he's saying that Abraham, who lived 2,000 years ago, has seen it. I mean, he clearly has it. He's lost it. But then in verse 58, Jesus says, "Very truly I tell you, before Abraham was, what?
I am.
I am who I am." Jesus is referencing God's, the name God revealed for God's self, and claiming it as his own. Jesus claimed to be God. And the people who heard him understood it, and you can tell by their reaction. In the text, it said they picked up stones to stone him, because what they were saying was they believed, they were convinced that Jesus had said that he was God, and they wanted to stone him on the spot for blasphemy. I am. So you may have heard this. I know I've heard it a number of times when you're in conversation sometimes with folks who aren't Christians, oftentimes really smart folks. But what you will hear is that Jesus, he never really, he was a fine teacher, a prophet maybe, but he never really claimed to be God. His disciples and then later on the church kind of put that on him, but Jesus never actually claimed to be God. Now, however intelligent the person is that is saying that, they are mistaken. Over and over again, and especially here, I wanted to highlight this line, Jesus clearly claims that he is God. "Very truly, I tell you, before Abraham was, I am." And so God, in this 2,000-year relationship with his people, developed in them this radical commitment to one God, monotheism. And then he cultivated within them this messianic expectation. And then came Jesus, the revelation of the second person of the Godhead, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Amen. This we believe. So my advice to you this morning is, strike while the iron's hot. Wait, that's another one of those sayings, isn't it? What does that mean? You know, I get this image of doing something violent to my iron while it's plugged in, sitting on the ironing board, and I think, no, that can't be right. And in fact, it isn't. This is another image that comes from earlier times. The iron referenced here, this is a blacksmith kind of image. This is an image from the blacksmith's forge. If you've been to St. Augustine, you know, you've seen the blacksmith, you put the iron in the red hot coals, and the metal itself begins to glow, and the blacksmith takes it out, and in order to really work the iron into the shape, he's got to strike it while the iron is hot to get the object that he wants to fashion. That's the image, is to take action at the opportune time to achieve the desired results. So we say, I believe in the Holy Spirit. And I love the explanation that St. Augustine offers. This analogy to help us understand. So we've got, I believe in God the Father Almighty. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. I believe in the Holy Spirit. And to help us understand this, this was in the 4th century AD. St. Augustine drew upon the image of the sun, the star at the center of our solar system. Augustine didn't have to know that at the time. But the sun, exploding ball of gases that we see, that is God the Father. The light from the sun that we can see, that's God the Son, S-O-N, that's Jesus. The energy that comes from the sun that causes plants to grow and perform photosynthesis, the warmth from the sun, that's God the Holy Spirit at work. And as Christians, we read in Scripture this concept of the Trinity that we confess, that we say we believe when we say the words of the Apostles' Creed. It's not that the word Trinity is not in the Bible. That is true. However, the Trinitarian nature of God shows up from the very beginning. In the book of Genesis, it begins this way. These words will be very familiar. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, skipping a little bit, a wind from God swept across the face of the water. That word wind, ruach in Hebrew, breath, spirit, same word. And then when God set about creating, what did he do? What does the Bible say in Genesis? God spoke. God spoke, and by God's word, all things came into being. It's what we read in the prologue of the Gospel of John. The beginning was the Word, but God spoke, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Word, the wind, the breath, all together from the beginning throughout Scripture. This we believe. You know, when I was a kid, I had the blessing of growing up in a Christian home. My parents took my sister and me to church multiple times a week. And so I heard all the stories about Jesus. I learned from the Old Testament and from the New Testament. There was a time as a kid when there was this challenge about I memorized all the books of the Bible from Genesis through Revelation. Don't ask me to say them all in order right now. I don't think I could do it. And when I was in third grade, our family was a part of a Baptist church. I made a profession of faith. I walked down the aisle while the congregation was singing "Just As I Am." I think it was verse 17, And I made a profession of faith. And I knew a lot about God. But, you know, for me, it wasn't until after my freshman year in college when there was a point in my life when I needed God the most, that he encountered me in a powerful way through the words of Jesus in the Gospel of Luke 15. Three things lost: the coin, the sheep, the son. And that belief that I had in my head moved in a more powerful way in my heart and began to come out of my hands and my feet. The belief that we are talking about is not just one that we assent to. It's like, I believe the grass is green. Belief. Credo. Is about our mind, yes. But it's about our heart and our hands and our feet. It's about how we live our lives every day. friends, what do you believe? Would you stand with me as we affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. I want to call your attention to those in the church family who are in need of our prayers. You see their names there. I am Chuck Schulstein and Gloria Levins. Very Sykes, Catherine, Betty Wells, Jesse Parks. There's also a few additional names. I think there we go. Betty is a neighbor of Harry Drendel, Irene Koch, Jean, who's Ellen Square's mother, and Russ Sexton. Are there other concerns, other joys that you would share for us to lift up to the Lord together?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Amen. Amen. This I believe. Amen. Let us pray. Oh God, what a privilege it is to be together as brothers and sisters proclaiming the truth that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. Amen. That you reign, that you are holy and sovereign and good. And in a world that sometimes seems to be coming apart at the seams, that somehow you are working out your plan and your purpose for good. For good. Lord, in these days, help us to place our hope firmly in you. While we pray for our leaders, while we are grateful for those who give of themselves for the civic good, we know that our ultimate hope lies not in who occupies a particular seat in a particular district or anything like that. Our hope, Lord, is in you. Lord, we pray for this land that your will would be done, that there would be peace and justice, and that you would use people like us who claim the name of Christ to be your ambassadors, to be agents of your peace, that you would break our hearts for what breaks your heart, O God. That we would be people of grace and kindness and compassion. That in these days of blue and red, right and left, and polarization, and the way that we are seem to be pulled apart, Lord, make us those who stand in the breach, who mend what is broken in the name of Jesus. Lord, with compassion and concern, we lift up those whose names have been displayed on the screen. Irene and Jesse, Kat and Betty, Chuck and Bonnie, Harry and Thane and Gloria and Russ. Carrie's neighbor, Betty, Evelyn's mother, God, you are the great physician. You have the words of eternal life. Your touch brings wholeness and healing. And we pray that for each of these situations. Lord, knit us together as brothers and sisters in Christ as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now as we continue our worship, we will get to experience the offertory. It's just a reminder that to help stop the transmission of COVID, the offering plate will be in the back on your way out. But know that the giving that we do is an act of worship in which we proclaim that all the gifts that we enjoy come from God's hand. Let us continue our worship. Gracious God, you are the giver of every good and perfect gift. The cattle on a thousand hills are yours, O Lord, and so we give up only a portion of what bounty you have entrusted to us. We pray that you would bless and multiply the gifts that are given through this congregation and congregations all across our area, the country, and the world, to accomplish your purpose, that the name of Jesus would be lifted up, that those who don't know you would come to believe and trust and encounter you in real and life-changing ways. Use even us for this your purpose, that all the world may know that you are God and you are holy and sovereign and loving and good. Bless gift and give. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. As we remain standing, let us sing together our closing hymn.
Oh,
this place today. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us sing our benediction together. And at the conclusion of the benediction, I invite you to stay for the congregational meeting that is coming up just following the service.
She turned it off, please.